Two beggars come out of the church after hearing a sermon on caring and sharing. One of them asks the other, "If you had two houses, would you give me one?" His friend says, "Yes, surely I would give you one house." "What if you had two cars? Would you give me one?" His friend again replies, "Of course, I would share my car with you." Then he asks, "If you had two loaves of bread, would you give me one?" The friend replies with a firm no. The other asks him, "Why not?" He says, "That is because I do have two loaves of bread." When people came to John for baptism, he advised them to share their goods with one another as a sign of their true repentance. We read about it in Luke chapter 3, verses 7 to 14. Verse 7, John said to the crowds who came out to be baptized by him, "You brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the coming wrath?" These are very strong words with which John addresses people who have probably traveled long distances to come to hear him speak, especially for baptism. These words that Matthew uses in his gospel for the Pharisees and Sadducees, Luke uses for the people in general who came to John for baptism. Why does he address them as brood of vipers? The viper was one of the most poisonous snakes around, and its bite could be fatal. It would cause the blood in its victim to congeal and the kidneys would fail, and as a result, the poison, instead of being expelled out of the body, would circulate within the body itself, leading to death. So naturally, people wanted to avoid any contact with this poisonous snake. Consequently, the term viper came to be used figuratively to designate people who were evil. A brood of vipers meant a family of young snakes produced at one hatching or birth. Viper comes from the Latin word vipera, which means live birth. The female viper does not lay eggs, but gives birth to live baby snakes. A viper is a snake which can be very deceptive. They have the ability to hide themselves in the surroundings and at times appearing as harmless sticks in the ground. So when they strike, they take their prey by surprise. John knew the desert very well, and also the animals and reptiles that existed in it. Luke chapter 1 verse 80 says, John was in the desert until the day of his manifestation to Israel. And hence he was using this analogy for those people who were evil and deceptive in their behavior and also hypocritical. John says, "You brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the coming wrath?" The desert had thin, short, dried up grass and stunted thorn bushes. In the event of a desert fire breaking out, it swept like a river of flame across the grass and the bushes. And in front of the fire, there would come scurrying and hurrying the snakes and the scorpions, who found shelter in the grass and in the bushes. They were driven from their lairs by this river of flame, and they ran for their lives before it. If the crowds are coming for baptism, John likens them to these serpents running for their lives before a desert fire. Even Jesus used this analogy of the brood of vipers when he addressed the Pharisees. He said, "You brood of vipers, how can you say good things when you are evil?" Matthew chapter 12 verse 34. Again, when he addressed the scribes and Pharisees, he said, "You serpents, you brood of vipers, how can you flee from the judgment of Gehenna or hell?" Matthew chapter 23 verse 33. In verse 8 it says, produce good fruits as evidence of your repentance. When we sincerely repent, we will show evidence of it in our changed lives. When Zacchaeus, the tax collector, encountered Jesus, many grumbled against Jesus, saying, he has gone to stay at the home of a sinner. We read that in Luke chapter 19 verses 1 to 10. But Zacchaeus stood his ground and silenced all accusing tongues when he made a declaration. He said, behold, half of my possessions, Lord, I shall give to the poor. And if I have extorted anything from anyone, I shall repay it four times over. Zacchaeus' repentance was complete when he made restitution. When we break our neighbor's window pane, we may express regret and sorrow. But that is not enough. We must get the window pane repaired as well. It doesn't make sense if I hit you on the head and say sorry and then keep hitting you again. I must stop hitting you on the head, and that will show that I am genuinely sorry. The latter part of verse 8 says, and do not begin to say to yourselves, we have Abraham as our father. For I tell you, God can raise up children to Abraham from these stones. John was challenging their set understanding, what they boasted of as being God's chosen people. So there was automatic salvation, they felt. To the Orthodox Jew, Abraham's merits were supposed to be sufficient not only for himself, but for all his descendants. John is challenging that kind of thinking. In other words, he's saying that a wayward generation cannot hope to claim salvation for the sake of noble ancestors. He has just called the people a brood of vipers because of their deception and hypocrisy. Evil children cannot hope to plead the merits of saintly or godly parents. It is not enough for a man to boast of a mother who may have taught Sunday school for 50 years. What about you? Do you know the basics of the faith? Do you know the catechism well enough? We have to appropriate the faith, the basic tenets of the faith. It is not enough to say that my father or my mother was so pious and so saintly, but I need to experience Jesus all over again for myself, and my faith needs to be a matter of conviction, not merely convention. John the Baptist goes on to say, don't boast of your progeny or your pious ancestry, for he says God can raise up children to Abraham from these stones. Now here the stone stands for a Gentile. Gentiles were sometimes called dogs or sometimes referred to as stones. God does not respect a person for the religion that he or she professes. God sees beyond the exterior. God is concerned with the condition of a person's heart. John goes on to say, verse 9, even now the axe lies at the root of the trees. Therefore, every tree that does not produce good fruit will be cut down and thrown into the fire. Uselessness or fruitlessness invites disaster. The person who is useless to God and to his fellow human beings is in grave danger of condemnation. At the end of the harvest season, in those days, the keeper of the vineyards and the fig trees would look at his vines and at his trees, and those which were fruitless and useless would be rooted out or cut down. They were only a burden on the ground. In the parable of the barren fig tree in Luke 13 verses 6 to 7, the owner came in search of fruit on it. But finding none, he said to the gardener, "For 3 years now I have come in search of fruit on this fig tree, but I have found none. Cut it down. Why should it exhaust the soil?" Hebrews chapter 6 verses 7 to 8 says, "Ground that has absorbed the rain falling upon it repeatedly and brings forth crops useful to those for whom it is cultivated receives a blessing from God. But if it produces thorns and thistles, it is rejected. It will soon be cursed and finally burned." Very true is that saying, we are saved in order to serve. In verse 10, it further reads, "And the crowds asked him, 'What then shall we do?'" The crowds have now been convicted by what John has said. Their question stems from his challenge to them to prove in concrete ways the heart change that they profess to have experienced. In spite of being rebuked by John, being called things like brood of vipers and all that, the crowd doesn't seem to be hurt by what he has said to them. They don't take offense at John, for they knew that what he was speaking was the plain and bitter truth. John replies to them, verse 11, "Whoever has two cloaks should share with the person who has none, and whoever has food should do likewise." He speaks about the cloak, which was the outermost garment that a Jew wore. It was also called the mantle, which could cover nakedness. It was the clothing of wanderers and the poor, who used it as a sleeping cover. For that reason, it was not to serve as collateral beyond sundown, when the owner would need it for the night. Exodus chapter 22 verses 25 to 27 makes clear what has just been said. It says, "If you lend money to any of my people who are poor, do not act like a money lender and demand interest from him. If you take someone's cloak as a guarantee that he will pay back the loan, if you take it as a pledge he owes you, you must give it back to him before the sun sets, because it is the only covering he has to keep himself warm. What else can he sleep in? When he cries out to me for help, I will answer him, for I am merciful." To be without such garments was a sign of extreme poverty. Job chapter 24 verse 7 says, "At night they sleep with nothing to cover them, nothing to keep them from the cold." Isn't this a sight with which we are familiar even in our city, Bombay? When we see people huddled together with barely sufficient clothing, even in winter. But it looks like that in our country the poor are worse off than the poor were in Israel in biblical times. They at least had a cloak with which they could cover themselves from the extreme cold. Now, if I look at my own cupboard, I find many shirts. There are many unstitched cloth materials. I wonder what John would have to say. John further said, "Whoever has food should share with him who has none." The paradox of starvation and food wastage in our country is that on the one hand, our country struggles to feed its starving population, while on the other hand, it wastes a lot of food. The average household wastes about 50 kgs of food per person per year. We Indians waste as much food as the whole of the United Kingdom consumes. The amount of food wasted in India every year is enough to feed all the people in the state of Bihar for an entire year. Bombay generates nearly 9,400 metric tons of solid waste per day, and 73% of this waste is food, vegetables and fruit. India may be the world's largest milk producer, and it grows the second largest quantity of fruits and vegetables after China, but it is also the world's biggest waster of food. Through this, it is obvious that we would rather throw food into the dustbin, extra or excess leftover food, rather than take the trouble to feed a hungry person with it. I wonder what John the Baptist would call us. Verse 12. Even tax collectors came to be baptized, and they said to him, "Teacher, what should we do?" Verse 13. He answered them, "Stop collecting more than what is prescribed." The sad part of it was that the tax collectors were Jews themselves, who collected the taxes Rome had imposed on their fellow Jews. The system of collection opened the door to many abuses. Authorities a certain amount of money each year for his district, for which he was responsible to collect taxes from. He would exact whatever sum he liked, provided Rome got the sum of money decided upon. He could take any amount of money from the people. There was no accountability with regard to that. Thus, injustice was widespread. The Roman taxes were a hated burden for the Jews, and the tax collector made that burden even more heavier, even more hated. So John is telling the tax collectors to be honest in their dealings with the people. In verse 14 it says, soldiers also asked him, "And what is it that we should do?" He told them, "Do not practice extortion. Do not falsely accuse anyone, and be satisfied with your wages." It is ironical that the soldiers asked John the Baptist for advice and counsel on what to do, instead of asking it from their commander or the centurion who was in charge of them. The soldiers were most likely accompanying the tax collectors mentioned in the earlier verse, verse 12. They were probably Roman soldiers who protected the tax collector from the zealots or from those who would refuse to pay the taxes. John was advising them not to assist the tax collectors in extortion. Soldiers, it seems, would have good enough reasons to accompany the tax collectors to the waters of baptism, for it is at the baptismal waters that one repents and turns away from his former way of life. So John is like a champion of social justice. We can conclude and sum up John's message in 3 or 4 points. Firstly, we learn to share our blessings with others. We learn not to take what rightly belongs to others, not to misuse the power and authority that we have been vested with. We need to be satisfied with what we possess. He told the soldiers, "Be satisfied with your wages." Let us conclude with a prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for John, who was a righteous person. Your word says, "Let a righteous man rebuke me." It'll be like the oil of anointing. Lord, we ask you to help us right what is wrong in our lives. Give us the true spirit of caring and sharing. Help us to be a blessing unto others, just as you've been a blessing unto us. It was through your poverty, Lord Jesus, that you have made us rich. Help us to be a channel of blessing, just as Abraham was. We ask you all these graces through Christ our Lord. Amen. Thank you.